Again, this is Mr. Wakefield, and this time we're going to be looking at section 2.2. This is at the bottom of the page in your packet that says 2.1 at the top. Okay, so now we're going to go down to the bottom here and look at section 2.2. You see here that the main topic of discussion is circles. Okay, again, just to start off real basic here, what is a circle? We all know it's round, of course, but what else do we know about that? What we know about a circle is that it has a center to it. But what makes it different from other round objects is that every single point on a circle, and this is not a perfect circle I'm drawing, it's not easy to draw one, but every single point on a circle is the same distance away. No matter which point you pick, every single point is the same distance away from that center. Okay. And so that distance there between the center and any point on the circle, which is always the same, that's called the radius. And so I'm going to call that R for short, R for radius. You see they mentioned that up here as well. So we have a center, we have the radius, okay. Let's go from there. You can see here we've got a couple of different equations that we use for formulas for circles. And this one right here obviously has the two brackets. It kind of looks like the distance formula, and that's not a coincidence. But it has the two brackets being squared with the plus in between it. But it has no radical. Instead, it has r squared on the other side now. This one right here is what happens when they ask you to deal with a circle, but the equation or formula doesn't have brackets in it. We'll talk about that as well. So let's go ahead and flip the worksheet over here, and we'll go ahead and get started. Okay, so let me flip that over now. And so, very first question says, use the following graph to determine the equation of the circle in center radius form. Okay. Then down here, and then next few problems after that, it then gives you the description of the circle, and you have to come up with the equation. You notice it says find the center radius form. That's the equation formula that we have right here with the two brackets in it. Okay, so basically what's going on here is that in the first problem here, they describe the circle by showing you the graph. You have to come up with the formula. Okay, in the next part here again, they describe the circle again, but this time describing it in words instead of with a graph. And they want you to come up with the equation there as well. Okay, so again, when they say center radius form, they're talking about that formula with the two brackets in it that we just looked at. So let's get started with that. In fact, I will go ahead and show you that formula right on the screen here at the same time so we could follow it more easily. There we go. Okay, and so there we go. So this is the formula we want to achieve here, number one. Notice that the formula has five different letters in it. The X and the Y, okay, are meant to be variables, okay? When you have a graph with an X-axis and a Y-axis, that means that the X and the Y are the variables when you find the equation that represents that graph. So the X and the Y will stay as X and Y, but the other three letters, we got to figure out what those are equal to, and we got to replace those three letters with those numbers that we figure out. So in other words, we need to look at this graph and we need to say, okay, what's the H and the K, which is the center, combining those two letters together, that's the center. Okay, and so let me just write this down here, H, K, and R, because that's what we're trying to figure out. But we also need to know the radius here. Can you see what the radius here is here? Okay, you can see that if we make a distance here from the center to the right side, for example, that's the easiest way to figure it out, is to either go right or left or up or down. You could see that in any of those directions, the radius is 2, isn't it? Okay, if you count over two spaces, you get to the side of the circle. Now, the center, since the center is 3, negative 2, you could see that that's where that point is. Let me write that down. Since the center is 3, negative 2, That means that the H is 3 and the K is negative 2. Okay, and so now we have everything that we need, okay, in order to come up with the what they call the center radius form. Okay, all we got to do is plug in those three numbers into this formula up here. Let's go ahead and do that. So x, and then remember the h is 3, so we're going to say x minus 3. The minus sign's already built into the formula there. Okay, bring down the plus, and then y. Notice that k is negative 2. So, and we've seen this before in the distance formula we looked at in the last section. Okay, since the k is negative, that let's read this carefully. It's y minus negative 2. Y minus negative 2. So once again, we have minus a negative, which is going to change that to a plus, right? Okay, because you're subtracting a negative. And then on the other side, please understand, you guys, the other side is not equal to 2. The other side is equal to the radius squared, so that would mean 2 squared, okay? And so that's why that's going to be 4, all right? So just a little reminder off to the side, that's r squared, okay? So this is the center radius form right here. That's part of your answer. It says, then also determine the general form of the equation. The general form, as you can see up here, that's the one where you, first of all, get rid of the brackets. Notice there's no brackets here, but you also get a zero on one side. So let me show you how to do those two things, getting rid of the brackets and then getting a zero on one side. The way to get rid of the brackets is just simply to multiply them out. We talked in a previous section before, when you have x minus 3, in other words, you have two terms in a bracket, two terms separated by either a plus or a minus, in this case a minus, and the brackets being squared, that means that in order to clear out those parentheses, we need to multiply that out like that, okay? Bring down the plus, and then we'll do the same thing for the same reason with the y plus 2 squared, okay? It's got two terms in there separated by a plus this time, and so two terms in a bracket, bracket being squared, that means that we need to expand it out like that. Okay, so let's multiply those two things out there. If I multiply these out, x minus 3 times x minus 3, I get x squared minus 3x plus 9. Okay, bring down this plus right here. There we go. And then we got y squared plus 2y plus 2y plus 4. Okay. And so now we're getting closer now. We got rid of the brackets here. All right. But we still need to get a zero on one side. And we also need to make it look like this. This means to combine some like terms right here. Okay. So I'm going to move the 4 over by subtracting it over. Okay. That's the way you want to do it. While you're at it, though, go ahead and combine like terms and also put the terms in this order. So I'm going to put the x squared first, obviously, like it is up here, okay? And then the y squared after that. And then minus 3x minus 3x is going to be minus 6x, isn't it? And then plus 2y plus 2y, because the y term is next, as you can see after the x term. Plus 2y plus 2y is going to be plus 4y. And then if I take the constant terms and combine them together, 9 plus 4 minus 4 is going to be 9. Okay, and then now that I've moved the 4 over, we now have a 0 on the other side. So you can see now that it looks exactly like the general form. X squared, y squared, you've got your x term after that, the y term, the constant term, which is what the f is, okay? D, E, and F are just constant numbers. So since there's no variable in the F term, okay, the 9 is the F there. And then the 0 on the other side of the equation. Okay. And so that is how you figure that out, by using the actual picture of the circle there, okay? Now, in the next set of problems here, again, they give us a physical description, or pardon me, a verbal description of the circle. And not only do they want us to find the center radius form, although you don't have to find the general form this time, just the center radius form with the two brackets, so a little bit less work there. But they also want us to graph the circle. Okay, so we'll talk about that. We haven't graphed a circle yet officially, so we'll talk about that. Now, coming down, let me pull this up here. And so, again, in order to find out the center radius form, we got to know three things. Just like in the last problem, we need to know what H is, we need to know what K is, and we need to know what R is, okay? And so, since the center is negative 2, 5, that means that the H is negative 2, the K is 5, and then since the radius is 4, that means R is 4, right? So, with all that in mind, that means that my equation is going to be what? Again, we're looking for the equation with the two brackets in it. X minus H, according to the formula, means that we need to do X minus negative 2. Sorry, that fell off the screen there. Let me move that over. I'll zoom out for you just a little bit there. Okay, so X minus negative 2 is going to be the same thing as X plus 2. Okay, with the square, just like the formula says, bring down the plus, as the formula says, and then y minus what? Y minus 5, and then that's equal to what? Okay, as you know, r equal to 4 means that this is not 4 right here, this is 16. You got to square that. Okay, so there is your equation right there. Okay. The other thing they wanted us to do, like I said, was to graph the circles, okay? But the good news here is that if you already know the center and radius, you just got to put those on there, okay? Let's do that carefully here. Let me zoom in here. I know my graphs are kind of, the marks on the graphs are kind of small here, so I want to make sure you can see. There we go. So, negative 2, 5, you count over 2 in this direction. Okay, and then the 5 right here. And so we graph where negative 2 and 5 would normally go. And there it is right there. And then the radius 4. Here's the easiest way to graph a circle. I want you to find 4 points before we actually draw the circle itself. Okay, and the way you do that is you just count 4 in every direction. You count 4 to the right. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'm going off of the center here. Remember, it's got to be a distance of 4 from the center. So we're going to go 4 to the right. We're going to go 4 to the left. Okay. I just want to make sure I counted this right. 3, 4, 5. Okay. So there we go. And then we're going to go 4 down. And then we're going to go 4 up. 1, 2, 3, 4 brings me up to 9, right? The number 9 up there on the y-axis. And so you can see here that a circle is starting to develop, but a lot of times students make the mistake when they try to graph this, it ends up looking more like a diamond, okay? Like a baseball diamond, if you prefer. We want it to make it look like a circle, obviously. So here's the key thing to do to make it look correct. You don't want to just suddenly go from this point, and then this point, and so on around. It'll look like a diamond, right? And no, what you want to do is, you start out at one point, and you go away from the center like this a little bit. Away from the center, and then cut back in at the last second towards the next point. And we just keep on doing that. You go away from the center a little bit, and then you cut back in, okay? Again, away from the center, and then you cut back in. One more time, away from the center and you cut back in. All right, now that's not the most perfect circle in the world. And when I test you guys, I'm not expecting perfection, but make sure it doesn't look like a diamond. Okay, it has to look at least reasonably close to a circle like this does. All right, and that's what I would expect from you. All right, now, so to wrap things up here, there is the equation and then there is the graph. Let's try that one more time now, okay? Notice in this one's kind of unusual because it says, let me move over here. There we go. It says here that the center is 0, 0. Okay, so that means that the H and the K are both 0. The radius, of course, is 9, as it says there. And so that creates an unusual situation here. If you look on our equation, this would be x minus 0 squared and y minus 0 squared. But the problem is that x minus 0 squared and y minus 0 squared, when you take something minus 0, the minus 0 doesn't need to be written. It's just like saying 7 minus 0. If I said, hey, what's 7 minus 0? You could say just 7 without the minus 0, okay, and that would be the right answer. So in the same way, if you have h or k being 0, you don't need to write the minus 0 there. You could just write x squared and y squared. Now, you might be wondering, wait a second, though. What about the brackets, though? Well, if the only thing you're squaring inside the bracket is a variable, no coefficient in front of it, okay, no nothing in front of it, just the x only is inside that bracket, or just the y only is inside the bracket, which is what's going to happen here if you have minus 0 inside the bracket, then in that case, when you just have x or y inside the bracket, you don't need the bracket. You could keep it if you want. You just don't need it. It's not mandatory. Okay, so writing it like this is perfectly fine when your center is 0, 0. The other side, of course, is going to be 81 because of the fact that the radius is 9. Okay, and so coming on over here, and this is our equation, all right? Remember, we don't have the brackets on this one, so that's just a normal equation. Otherwise, here we went right off of the center radius form as they asked us to do. It just looks different because the brackets aren't there. So we're now ready to graph it, all right? And the center is what we always start out with when we graph a circle, and then we use our radius to build off of that. So if we go 9, because the radius is 9, if we go 9 to the right, 9 to the left, okay, 9 up, and 9 down. Remember, you take the radius and you go left, right, up, and down. That gives you your four main points, and that's what you can use to draw your circle from. Okay, and again, what did we learn in the last problem about actually physically drawing the circle? We don't make a diamond, okay? We don't just go straight from one point to the other. We instead, what? We cut away from the center, like this, away from the center and come back in, away from the center and come back in, and finally, one more time, away from the center and then come back in, okay? And again, not the most perfect looking circle, but close, all right? That's what's important. All right, couple more problems here in this section, you guys. Like I mentioned when we talked about what was on the front side of the worksheet, which is this stuff right here that I'm looking at right now with my pencil. Sometimes your equation of the circle looks like this, okay? Notice that the next two problems are similar to that. They're giving us these equations, and then the directions say, find the center radius formula of each of the following circles. So they're telling you that these equations represent circles here. They're actually telling you that, all right? You don't have to figure that out. Because of the fact that they represent circles, we need to take these equations, you guys, 4 and 5, and we need to make them look like the center radius form. How in the world, though, are we going to take 4 and 5 and make them look like the center radius form with the two brackets in? That's what we're going to talk about, okay? In order to give myself enough room, I'm going to do the work down here mostly at the bottom. So let's get started here. What you need to do, and this is going to be similar to the completing the square technique that we learned back in Chapter 1, but what you want to do is, first of all, take the x squared term and the x term and put them next to each other. Okay, you're just rearranging the terms, so don't change the signs of the terms. Just rearrange them. Okay, so y squared is still positive and 10y is still positive, all that stuff. Okay, oh, you know what? I made a little bit of a mistake there, but we'll fix it. Didn't really write anything wrong there. I just didn't leave some space that I needed to leave there. What I want you to do is, after you write down the X terms, I want you to make some space there. And then I also want you to make some space after the Y terms like that. Okay. The negative 25 is still on the other side. Keep that there. Okay, but the reason why we made space there is because we're going to complete the square, but we're going to do it twice this time. Let's remind ourselves of what completing the square means. Okay, back in chapter one, we had this problem right here, for example, where we took the coefficient of the x term, negative 4, and what did we do with that? We took it and we, hold on a sec. There we go. We took it and we divided it by 2. Okay. And so we divided it by 2. And then after we figured that answer out, we then squared that. Okay. And so that's why I added 4 to both sides, it's because that's what I got when I did that. Let's do that same thing here, but we're going to do that with, again, the coefficient of x. But also the coefficient of y. Okay, two different things here because we have two different variables. Sorry, that fell off the screen there. The negative 12 we're going to do it with because that's the coefficient of x, and then the 10 because that's the coefficient of y. So let's do that first of all with the negative 12. If you divide that by 2, you get negative 6. And then you square negative 6, put a bracket around it to make sure you square the negative also, not just the 6, and we get 36. Okay, so here's what that means. That means that you take the 36 and you add that to the x terms because it came from the negative 12, which was from the x. But you cannot add something to one side of an equation without adding it to the other side. And so, just like when we completed the square back in chapter one. And so, remember to add it to this side too. We're now going to do that same thing with 10. There we go. 10 divided by 2 is 5. We then divide the 5, or pardon me, we square the 5 after we divide by 2, and that gives me 25. So that result then, since it came from the b, or pardon me, since it came from the y term, I'm going to add that behind the y's here. And since it was 25 that I added to the left side, I'm going to add 25 to the other side as well. Whatever you add to one side, you got to add it to the other. Now, as we learned back in the completing the square chapter or section, you could factor this thing and it ends up being the same two brackets. It should always be that, if, otherwise it, something went wrong. But the shortcut that I showed you also was that whatever you squared, see how the thing that I ultimately squared here in that last section? That was, or in the completing the square section, when I finally found the answer 4, it was negative 2 that I squared to get that. Okay. So the thing that you square to get that final number that you add to both sides, that's the thing that actually goes inside the bracket there that gets squared. So as a shortcut, you don't have to write down the step with the two brackets. You can just cut right to this. You put your variable in there. You put your minus 2 in there. If it had been positive 2, you'd put plus 2 in there. But either way, you can cut right to that. Let's do that same thing here. For the x's, we squared negative 6. So that means that the bracket is going to be x minus 6. Minus 6 because it was negative 6. Bring down that plus right there, and then we'll do the same thing for the y's and the 25. That all of that becomes what? That all becomes y. And then because it was 5 that we squared, that is what's going to go in there. Okay. And then on the other side of the equation, figure that out as well. You can see here that if we add those together, we end up getting 36. Does it now look like the thing that it's supposed to look like, which is the center radius form? Does it look like that now, you guys, from the front side of the worksheet? It sure does look like that with the two brackets, the plus in between, okay, and the constant number on the other side. Remember, x and y are the only variables, so the r squared has to be just a normal constant number. It is. Now that it looks like that, and only now do you do this. Don't do this until after you make it look like the center radius form. But once it looks like that, then you're allowed to figure out what the h and the k are equal to, and also what the r is equal to. Okay, but you got to get into this form first. So what is the h and k? And this is where we need to be careful. Okay, because of the fact that the minus sign is already built into the formula here, okay, that means that in order to figure out the h from the equation, remember before when we figured out the h, they just told us what the center was already, okay? They told us that up here. And so we just took negative 2 and 5. But if you get it from the equation, okay, if you figure out what h and k are from the looking at the equation, you have to change the signs of these numbers inside of the brackets that go with the x and the y. So that means that the h is 6 and the k is negative 5. So in other words, the center is 6, negative 5. Okay, this makes sense because if I now go backwards and I, let's pretend like I was doing one of those previous problems here where they gave me the center and I had to figure out the equation. If I plugged in 6, wouldn't it be x minus 6 in that previous problem? Okay, whereas if I had plugged in negative 6 into the formula, it would have had to become x plus 6 because you would have had the double negative. Remember, the minus sign is already built into the formula. And so that's why it makes sense to change the signs to figure out h and k when you're figuring out those numbers from the equation. Okay. What is the radius? Well, because the number over here is supposed to be r squared, okay, r squared is 36. Remember, the number on the other side, when you get it into this form, is not r, it's r squared. So if r squared is 36, what must the radius be? Well, what number would you square to get 36? 6, right? Okay. Yes, it's true that you could square negative 6 to get 36 as well. I commend you if you're thinking about that. That's good thinking. But the reason why the answer is 6 and only 6 is because the radius is a type of distance, and distance can never be negative. So it can only be 6 and not negative 6. Okay. Now that I know what the center and the radius are equal to, let's go back up to the graph here and let's plot those things. 6, negative 5 is going to be right there. Now we're going to go off the page here just slightly, but that's okay. All right, that's not completely wrong to do that. Okay. So we need to go what? In fact, I'm going to extend this out just slightly, 11, 12 right there. So we're going to go 6 to the right, 6 to the left, 6 up. It's going to bring me to there. And then if I count 6 down, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. And then I'm ready to draw my circle. Okay. Just the same way I've been doing it here, okay? It's okay that you cut in front of your numbers there, all right? I can see what your work is still there, okay? And so that's the circle. So once again, we have what? We have the center radius form. That is your answer there when they ask you for the center radius form. And then you have your graph, okay? Okay, now in number 5, you guys, this is where things get really interesting here. Notice that unlike in the last problem, we don't have just x squared and y squared this time. We've got 9x squared and 9y squared. So that's kind of like this problem that we saw back in chapter 1 when we were completing the square as well. We have to get rid of any coefficient that's in front of the x squared term before we do that thing where we divide by 2 and then square it, okay? We got to do the getting rid of that coefficient first. So In this particular instance, and I'm just going to rewrite the problem down here so we'll have enough room. But we need to get rid of those nines right there, the x squared term and the y squared for that matter, since we're also going to be completing the square with the y as well. We need to get rid of the 9 from both of those before we do that thing where we divide by 2 and then square. So I'm going to divide that out like that. And what does that lead to here? Okay, 9x squared divided by 9, positive divided by positive is positive, but also we know that the 9s cancel, so that's going to give me x squared. 9y squared divided by 9, the 9s cancel. In other words, if you were to, without writing out all this, you know that if I were to break this up into different terms here, just like we have seen in the past where you divide each term individually, which is what you do when you got a big polynomial on top and a single term on the bottom. You just divide each term individually, and then each individual term you can cancel or reduce. Okay, so you get x squared, you get y squared. Here, the 12 and the 9, if you have that right there, that's going to be 12x over 9. That's going to end up reducing down to what? That's going to reduce down to 4 over 3 with the x still being there. So that's going to be 4x over 3. Excuse me. And negative 18y over 9, if you were to do that one, that's going to become negative 2y, isn't it? Negative 2y over 1. Okay, and so that's just the same thing as negative 2y. And then negative 23 ninths. Again, I put a minus in front because that is negative divided by positive. Okay, and then 0 over 9 is 0. 0 divided by anything is 0, as long as you're not dividing by 0. And so one other thing I want to mention before we go any further. When you have 4x over 3, you guys, as long as the x is being multiplied by the rest of the top there, the 4, you can pull the x out behind that, and that's really going to help us here, okay? In fact, you have to do that. So if the x is inside the numerator there in one of these completing the square problems, you got to, assuming you've done all of your separation here, you've separated this into 5 different terms here, and you've just got the part here, you know, where you have the x with that's just a part of one term, 4x there. In that case, you got to pull the x out at that point so that you can see exactly what's being multiplied by the x there. It's not just the 4, but it's the 4/3. So you got to pull that x out there in order to realize that. Okay, so we have our equation here. What we want to do, just like we did in the last problem, is we separate. Now that I have x squared and y squared with no nines in front of it, I do the same thing I did in the last problem here. Okay. I leave enough room there, okay, to put some numbers in here. And excuse me there, I forgot to mention also, don't write zero there, because we're going to add 23 ninths over to the other side. If we add 23 ninths to 0, of course, that's going to be equal to 23 ninths because you're adding it to 0. That's not going to change the fact that it's still 23 ninths. And now what? Well, at this particular point, what I need to do is I need to take 4/3, divide it by 2, and then square it. Okay. Now, let me do that off to the side since I'm running out of space here a little bit. Let me do that off to the side here. How do you do a fraction divided by 2? Okay, the way you do that is to realize that 2 is the same thing as 2 over 1. And when you divide fractions, you multiply by the reciprocal, right? So when you have when you have a fraction divided by 2, it's the same thing as fraction times 1/2. Fraction divided by 2, fraction times 1/2. And that gives me 4/6, which reduces down to 2/3. And so remember, you just divided by 2 so far. You have not squared it yet. So the thing that we want to square is the two-thirds then, isn't it? And so what is two-thirds squared? That is 4/9. Okay, so what we want to do right here is we want to add 4/9. But if I add 4/9 to one side, I have to add 4/9 to the other side. Okay, let me get organized here. There we go. This other one is a lot easier here. Okay, when I have negative 2, let me move this up here so you can see it. When I have negative 2 and I divide it by 2, I get what? I get negative 1, right? No fraction that time to worry about. And then negative 1 squared is 1, isn't it? Okay. And so that means that we're going to, and again, where did I get the negative 2 from? The negative 2 was the what? Just like in the last problem. Okay, you take the coefficients of x and y. That's why I did 4/3 and I did negative 2. 4/3 and negative 2 were the things that I divided by 2, right? Okay, that's why. It's because they're the coefficient of x and the coefficient of y. Anyway, I just wanted to explain that there. So I add 1 to both sides here because 1 was the result that I got for the y part here when I did the completing the square technique. Now, when you got fractions, that shortcut that I showed you is really helpful here. Remember, I said that whatever you square, you guys, whatever you square is the thing that goes inside the bracket here that's being squared. So the x goes in there, not x squared, but just the x goes in there now when it goes inside the bracket. And then what did I square, you guys? I squared 2/3, didn't I? Not 4/3. That still had to be divided by 2. Now you got 2/3 being squared, so that means I put x plus 2/3 in there. Plus because it's positive. Okay, plus because it's positive. Bring down the plus sign there. And then y, what? Y, and then what did I square? I squared negative 1, right? Negative 2 still needed to be divided out first, but then negative 1 was what I squared. And so because it's negative 1 instead of 1, I say y minus 1. Okay, now finally, what is the other side of the equation equal to when I add those together? Well, first of all, 23/9 and 4/9, okay, they're very nice to us here. Since the denominators are the same, I can add those together. You can't add fractions without that. But because the nines are the same, I can say 27/9. Okay, 27/9 though is what? 27/9 is 3. 27/9 is 3. If you reduce that fraction. And so that's 3 plus 1. Okay. But what is 3 plus 1? 3 plus 1 is, in fact, I'll write this down over here. I don't know why I'm writing it on the left side. This is 3 plus 1 here equal to 4, isn't it? So let's just change this to a 4. There we go. We're almost there. Okay. The tough part of the problem is over. All right. Four. Because now, you guys, what do we got? We got the center radius form of the circle. It took us a while to get there, but we got there. All right. So now that I've got that and I've got it all circled, I know what it is. Okay. What is my HK and R? What is my HK and R? H is the 2/3. The K is the, hold on just a second. I stand corrected there, you guys. I was getting a little bit too fast, a little bit too far ahead of myself there. I was thinking of the center already. Remember, as we said in the last problem there, in order to figure out the H from the equation and also the K, you have to change the sign of the numbers that are in there. So if it's positive 2/3, you're going to get negative 2/3. For the k, because you see minus 1 in there, that's going to be positive 1. So the center is going to be negative 2/3, comma 1. Okay. All right. So just remember, you guys, when you look at the equation, if the equation is already in center radius form, okay, the numbers that you see in there, you got to change the signs of them in order to figure out what h and k are. Okay, So 2/3 of negative 1, that means the center is the opposite of that. Negative 2/3, positive 1. All right. And so what's the R? The R is got to be whatever's being squared to get 4. All right. Since the R squared is 4, that must mean that the R is 2. Okay. Now, when you graph a fraction, you guys, I'm not expecting perfection here once again. I know that's not the easiest thing to do. The only thing I expect is that you put it kind of in the approximately the right place. Okay. Since it's a fraction, I just want you to put it halfway is fine. Just put it halfway between the two numbers that it should be between. Since negative 2/3, you guys, is halfway, or it's not literally halfway, but it's close enough. It's between 0 and negative 1, okay? Just like if I had 2/3 of an apple, you guys, that would be between 0 and positive 1 apples, right? So in the same way, negative 2/3 should be between 0 and negative 1. Let me say it again. 2/3 of an apple is between 0 apples and 1 apple. So negative 2/3 of an apple, okay, is the same thing on the opposite side. It's going to be between 0 and negative 1. All right, so all you got to do is take the negative 2/3 and just put it between 0 and negative 1 right here. Also keeping in mind that the y is equal to 1. So that's going to be right about there, okay? Again, the x is between 0 and negative 1. The y is exactly equal to positive 1. And then what do we do? Since the radius is 2, keep in mind that this point is halfway between 0 and negative 1. So when you count 2 to the right, just kind of stay halfway between each mark here. So I'm now going to be still halfway between these two marks, but I count it over 1, 2. Same thing the other direction, 1, 2. I'm still halfway between those two marks there, but it's a distance of 2 going over there. Okay. And then I go up 2 and down 2. And we're just about ready to draw the graph. Now, like always, you guys, no diamonds. We make it go away from the center. Okay. And then cut back towards the point. Away from the center and then cut back to the towards the point. Do that for every single one of those 4 points there. Again, not the most perfect circle, but close enough. Okay. And so, let me zoom back out there. So that is what happens there. All right. So to summarize here, you guys, if you have not just x squared, but 9x squared or 9y squared, you got to get rid of those 9s doing what we just did here. Okay. And make sure to divide each one of these terms one at a time. Okay. Doing just what we just did right here. Okay. And then that'll give you the appropriate coefficients to then complete the square on. Okay. Let me know if you have any questions about any of this in section 2.2. Contact me. And again, have a nice day.